Well, hello, church family, and welcome to our Wednesday evening time of Bible study and worship. Let me encourage you this evening to be sure and participate with us as we sing some songs that honor and glorify our Savior, and then we hear a word from the Lord from our pastor, Brother Mike. All right, here we go. To God be the glory. Church family, great things he has done. Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done in me. Let the weak, let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done in me. Hosanna, Hosanna. to the river I will wade, where my sins are washed away. From the heavens' mercy stream of the Savior's love for me, I will rise from waters deep into the saving arms of God. I will sing salvation's song. Jesus Christ has set me free. Hosanna, Hosanna to the Lamb that was slain. Hosanna, Hosanna, Jesus died and rose again. Hosanna, Hosanna to the Lamb that was slain. Hosanna, Hosanna, Jesus died and rose again. Let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Let the blind say, I can see. It's what the Lord has done in me. My hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross has Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. This is the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save. Is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder. There's nothing has the power to save. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder. There's nothing has the power to save. Is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nation sing it louder. There's nothing has the power to save. I love to sing, it's worth it. Sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus.
Grab your Bible tonight, if you would. Open with us to 1 Samuel. We'll be in chapter 15, 1 Samuel chapter 15, as we open God's Word together tonight. This is a pivotal chapter in the story of Saul, but it's also one of the most distressing passages in all of the former prophets. Saul was given the high privilege of fulfilling a prophecy that was made back in the days of Moses, and that prophecy was that of annihilating the Amalekites. God was giving Saul another opportunity to prove himself, but he fails again, he lies about it, and he was judged as a result of it. The Lord will reject Saul as king for his failure to follow the Lord's commands. And so we're going to look together in 1 Samuel chapter 15. We're going to begin looking tonight. We're only going to look in the first three verses because there's some very important things that we need to talk about here in these verses. But we're going to see in the life of Saul that God does take disobedience to his commands very seriously. And he does not make light of that. He does not excuse that whatsoever, but that he takes very seriously whether we obey his commands or whether we disobey his commands. We're going to look tonight, concentrate in these first three verses, and we're going to see the command that Saul is given, and we're going to look at the challenges of this command and how even in modern day culture, how we wrestle with the command that Saul is given. And so let's look together in these verses tonight. Beginning in verse 1, 1 Samuel 15, the Bible says, "Then Samuel said to Saul, 'The Lord sent me to anoint you as king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore listen to the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel, how he set himself against him on the way while he was coming up from Egypt. Now go and strike Amalek and utterly destroy all that he has, and do not spare him. But put to death both man and woman, child and infant, ox and sheep, camel and donkey.'" We're going to see several things as we walk through this entire chapter, but what I want us to begin to see tonight is the destruction commanded. The destruction that was commanded. This chapter begins with the reappearance of Samuel, the spiritual leader of Israel, bringing a message from the Lord to Saul, the military and political leader of Israel. And the message that Samuel brings from God to Saul is very clear. God clearly tells Samuel to tell Saul, utterly destroy the Amalekites. And Saul was deliberate in telling Saul, Samuel was deliberate in telling Saul who was giving this command. At the outset of verse 2, Samuel states, "Thus says the Lord of hosts." Your translation may say, "Thus says the Lord Almighty." It may say, "the Lord of armies." But this is the very first time in Scripture that this title, the Lord of hosts, is used. It's used a total of 76 times in the Scripture, and every time it's in the former or latter prophets. And the title is always used by a prophet to introduce an authoritative revelation. And so Samuel is making very, very clear to Saul that this command that is being given to him was given by the Lord, and it's given with all the authority that the Lord possesses. And we know that God is almighty, that he is all that all authority has been given to him, as Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28. Now, who were these Amalekites that God was sending Saul to utterly destroy? Well, the Amalekites were perpetual enemies of Israel, and they were, to put it very simply, some pretty bad people. They were, as what we might consider today, extremists. They were people that that did not value life. They did not value anything other than what they could possess they could possess themselves. It was no problem for them to massacre people. It was no problem for them to desolate cities. They were a utterly perverse and wicked people. The whole conflict between Israel and Amalek began when Israel was on its way out of Egypt and toward the Promised Land. And here was Israel alone and defenseless in the wilderness, and the Amalekites raided them. And how they raided them was the Amalekites snuck up behind Israel and they attacked the old and the young who were trailing at the back of the caravan of people. It was common in that time when there was a massive group of people that the armies would be out front, that the strong would be out front, and that the weaker would be those in the back. And that way the strong and the mighty and the courageous, they could protect those who were weak. And the Amalekites saw this as an opportunity to attack from behind. And so they sneak up behind and they begin to pick off Israel, and they begin to pick off the weakest among them. Now, God rescued Israel from the Amalekites in the midst of that. But God had stated that he would eventually bring judgment on the Amalekites as a result of what they did to Israel as they were leaving Egypt headed to the Promised Land. But this Amalekite opposition was not a one-time event. Throughout Israel's history, the Amalekites were constantly provoking and pillaging Israel. They were renowned for excessive violence and excessive ruthlessness. God had, to this point in chapter 15, given Amalek 400 years to repent, 400 years to turn from their wickedness and their ruthlessness, 400 years to turn from their sinfulness and turn to God, 400 years to turn from worshiping false gods to worshiping the one true God. But his patience, God's patience, had run out, and it was time for judgment. It was time for them to be held accountable, not only for the sin that they had committed as Israel had left Egypt, but to be held accountable for the sin that they had committed throughout Israel's history and all of the damage that they had done to God's people. Saul was to be the tool of God in this judgment, as God tells him to wipe out the nation of Amalek completely. And so God could have chosen to have done as he did with Sodom and Gomorrah and just brought judgment down from heaven. But God was giving Saul an opportunity here to be the tool that he would use to enact judgment upon Amalek for the sins that they had committed against God and against Israel. Now, this was not a war of conquest. This was a war of justice. The goal of the attack was not to enlarge Saul or enlarge Israel. The goal of the attack was not to make Saul rich. The goal of the attack was not to fill Israel's barns with plenty. The goal was to execute justice on a rebellious group of people. And Saul was explicitly told to take no prisoners and to leave the wealth alone. This kind of warfare, called harem, which is the word used in the Hebrew, was practiced only against people who had come under the Lord's severest judgment And it's what some today would call holy war. Not that that's a term that we would ascribe to it, not that that's a term that we would even agree with, but that some have called it. But what God is calling for here in the Hebrew is called harem. Some have referred to it as divine warfare, which is probably a better term for it. But it's a warfare of judgment. It's not a warfare of conquest, but it's a warfare in which those who've been supremely wicked, people who have opposed God at the very core and have continually done that, would be the recipients of God's severest judgment. The task Saul is commanded to do was a solemn and a holy one, this enactment of harem. And since he and those Israelites who carried it out functioned as the Lord's agents of judgment, they were to carry it out explicitly as the Lord commands. Now, some people today find the Lord's commands here difficult to digest. And it leads us to questions such as, why in the world would God order something as brutal as this? Utterly destroy, completely annihilate. And why destroy the animals? Well, why destroy the women and the children? Why is a later generation of the Amalekites punished as a result of the sins of an earlier generation? And why is Saul sparing one man and some livestock? Why is such a serious offense? Why is that such a serious offense to God? You see, this what God commands here prompts all these questions, and really, for modern ears, this whole thing sounds disturbingly like Islamic jihad. So when we read this in our 2020 culture, when we read this instruction, this direct command that God gives to Saul to enact harem against the Amalekites, it causes these questions to surface, and it brings some disturbance to people's ears and to our hearts. Commands like the Lord gives here in 1 Samuel 15, it challenges us. So we shouldn't just skip past this text without attempting to resolve the struggle. Our faith doesn't need to be diminished here. In fact, our love for and commitment to the Lord can be made stronger here. It can be enlarged here. And so I want us to consider tonight some realities that can help us resolve our struggle and that will strengthen our faith when we think about this harem, this divine warfare that is being instructed for Saul to carry out on the Amalekites. And I want to show us three things that I think will be helpful for us when we think about harem, divine warfare, God's divine judgment being carried out through the agency of military conquest and military warfare. The first thing that we need to realize is that God in His holiness demands that sin be punished. God in His holiness demands that sin be punished. The primary reason that the Amalekites were being utterly destroyed was that they were exceedingly sinful. And you see that throughout the book of Leviticus, throughout the book of Numbers, throughout the book of Deuteronomy, and throughout the books of 1 and 2 Samuel. These were an utterly sinful and wicked people. And if they were not totally wiped out, they would teach the Israelites their sinful ways and thus bring the Israelites under divine condemnation. If you're at all familiar with the Old Testament, you know that when God's people didn't carry out the command to totally drive out other nations, and they allowed some of those nations to remain in the land, they wound up influencing God's people away from allegiance, singular allegiance to God alone, and pushed them toward worshiping false gods. You remember the story of Solomon, this man who was the wisest man to ever live outside of Jesus. And we see that God had entrusted him with this great wisdom, and God had given him the order to build the temple that was such a marvelous edifice that was a testimony not only to Solomon's wisdom but to God's glory. But Solomon, the Bible talks about Solomon loved many strange or many foreign women, and he began to marry them. And we hear about all of these wives and concubines that he has. And it's, the Bible says this very clearly, that Solomon's wives turned his heart away from the Lord. And so we see so vividly throughout the Old Testament that when people are allowed to remain in the land where God's people would dwell, they would influence God's people away from allegiance and worship of the Lord alone. And so if these Amalekites were not completely wiped out, they would influence God's people and also make them the objects who would come under divine condemnation. Every part of the Amalekite culture had been deeply influenced by this prevalent wickedness. There was nothing in Amalekite culture that was untouched by the wickedness of the Amalekites. The only hope of purging the wickedness was eliminating all who had been infected by their wickedness. And so God was bringing punishment on the sinfulness of these people because His holiness demanded punishment for sin. And we think about it in, moving forward in the Scripture, and we know that the cross of Calvary is a testimony to God's holiness dealing very swiftly and very severely with sin. God's holiness demands that sin be punished. God doesn't excuse sin. He doesn't overlook sin. God in His holiness punishes it. So that's one thing that we can take from this text, one thing that we learn, one thing that can help us as we wrestle with the command that God gives to Saul to utterly destroy this people. But a second thing that we need to realize when it comes to this matter of harem and divine warfare is that divine warfare is not genocide or ethnic cleansing, but instead is the elimination of false worship. That's what divine warfare is. It is the elimination of false worship, because there is only one who is worthy of our worship, and that is Jehovah God. That is Yahweh. That is the Lord that is the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one true God. He alone is worthy of worship. And so divine warfare represents a focused attack on sinful and idolatrous religion rather than simply an attack on people. And that is so crucial for us to understand. Divine war represents a focused attack on sinful and idolatrous religion rather than simply an attack on people. You see, to get at the religious heart of an ancient people, one had to engage more than just their spiritual lives. If you wanted to get at the spiritual heart of people, it required more than, a sermon series. It required more than a study series. The ancients didn't separate the realm of the secular from the sacred as we so often do today. Ancient peoples like Israel and Amalek saw their identities bound up with three factors. They saw their identities bound up with their particular place, the land in which they lived. They saw their identities bound up in their particular God, the God that they worshiped. And they saw their identities wrapped up in their particular people group. And all three were very significant. Where they lived, the land that they lived in, the God that they worshiped, and the people whom lived in that land and worshiped the same God that they did. So for example, the Moabites lived in a land southeast of the Jordan River, and they worshiped Chemosh. They believed Chemosh cared for the Moabites in that particular place. So the reason that you worshiped Chemosh was because you were a Moabite who lived in this particular place. You see, in our world today, there are many people who believe that, many people in other countries who believe that because you are an American, you're a Christian. And so, again, you see this mentality even this many thousand years later of this triad of the land you live, the gods you worship, and the people that you're a part of, and it all being a part of one another. And many times you go outside the country, you begin to talk with people about their faith, and they believe that just because you're an American, you are a Christian. And we know that that's not the case whatsoever. But here we have the Moabites as an example, and because they worshiped the God they worshiped, and they lived the land they lived in, believing that Shamash, the God that they worshiped, protected them and protected the people who lived in their land. Then you have the Canaanites, and they revered the god Baal, and who governed them in the land of Canaan, and they believed that Baal watched over them, protected them, and protected the people of their land. And then you have the Israelites, and they worshiped Yahweh in the promised land. And the Canaanites were obviously, they were very opposed to the Israelites, but they didn't worship the same God. They didn't have the same belief systems there. Well, divine warfare fundamentally breaks the bonds within the deity, people, and land triad. It breaks that apart. When the Amalekites were defeated and they were displaced, their gods were defeated and revealed as powerless and false, and Yahweh was revealed as powerful and true. So when Israel comes against the Amalekites are destroyed, then it is viewed that Yahweh, Israel's God, was greater than the Amalekites' God. And that happened not just in this instance, but that happened in all warfare amongst all nations. When one land would overtake another land, then it was viewed that their God was more powerful than the one whom they had attacked. And so God is asserting his authority and his supremacy in this matter. So divine warfare is not genocide or ethnic cleansing. It's the elimination of false worship. But a third thing I want us to see tonight is that in divine warfare, there is a communal aspect to justice. Now, as Westerners, we tend to think about justice individually. Every person stands before the court of law alone. But other people, especially countries in the East, they think about justice communally. And the ancient world saw things that way as well. They viewed justice communally. And both the individual and the communal aspects of justice contain an element of truth. We in the West probably need to be reminded of the communal aspects much more often, because we are so prone to an individualistic idea and mentality. We are, in fact, inextricably united to our community. What we do affects others in our community, and what others in our community does affects us. When a person chooses to drive an automobile impaired and they collide with another person, that person who's being collided with is in an accident not due to their own bad decision, but because of the other person's bad decision. They are the recipient of their community's decision. This can work positively as well. You're raised in a family that loved you, that pointed you to Jesus, that encouraged you to succeed. You were blessed by the righteous acts of your parents. You were the recipient of the behaviors and the attitudes and the actions of someone other than yourself. So the communal view held by those in Eastern culture and in the ancient Near East is accurate. We can never be fully separated from our community. We are a part of that community. So while we in Western culture prefer to see justice meted out on an individual level, which it most often is, it is still appropriate for justice to be meted out on a communal level as well. In a passage like this, when God delivers someone over to death because of the actions of their community as a result of the actions of their people group. The communal side of the equation is made to seem most prominent. And we should not, however, assume that this is a normative pattern for exacting justice. God worked in a unique situation in a way that was uncommon, but that in no way compromised His holiness, His goodness, or His character. In no way did He do that. In fact, we see God's character in the 400 years between the Amalekites' initial attack on Israel and God's command for Saul to utterly destroy them. He had given them 400 years to repent, 400 years to turn away from their false gods, 400 years to worship Him alone, 400 years to give their lives unto Him and to living in obedience to His command, of turning away from their wickedness and their ruthlessness and all the vile things that they did. He gave them 400 years to turn away from that. And they never turned away. In fact, they perpetually lived in a state of sinfulness and wickedness. You see, no person falls under the judgment of God totally innocent, because the reality is we're all sinners. The Bible makes that very clear, not just in the New Testament, but the Old Testament. We are all sinners. So no person falls under the judgment of God completely innocent. We've all sinned, fallen short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, not even one. So there's not any person who has ever or will ever fall under the judgment of God who is completely innocent. In fact, every person who falls under the judgment of God is guilty before God because they are sinners, and sin makes us guilty before God. And we need to recognize that, need to understand that there's not a single individual that's innocent. We are guilty before God, sinners in need of a Savior. And the reality is, friend, if you've never accepted Christ, you're guilty before God. You say, now hold on a minute, preacher. I mean, I haven't taken anyone's life. I've not taken someone else's property. I've not been guilty of perjury and telling lies against people. Any of that. I've tried to do good by people. I've tried to help people. I've tried to live a good life. I don't think I'm guilty before God. Well, the reality is none of us have lived a perfect life. In fact, we've all fudged on the truth a time or two. We've not been obedient to our parents when we are younger, or when we were younger. We've not loved our spouse as well as we could have. We've not treated people the way God would have had us to do. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We all stand guilty before God. And the only way that you and I can escape the punishment on our sin is to come to faith in Jesus Christ. And if you've never trusted Jesus Christ, your Savior, if you want to talk to someone about doing that, we want to ask you to contact us, to get in touch with us so that we can help you in making that decision and guide you toward Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus was already punished for the sin of all of those who will place their faith and trust in Jesus. So if you would come to faith in Christ, then what Jesus did on the cross would stand as the substitute, your substitute, taking the punishment for your sin. I would ask you to reach out to us. You can email us at sebcmuskogee@gmail.com. You can contact us by text or phone, 918-844-0585, and we'd love to follow up with you. The reality is every person apart from Christ is guilty before God. And the only way to escape the punishment on our sin is to place our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, who was punished in our place. What we need to understand tonight is these Amalekites were not punished because they were innocent. They were punished because they were guilty. They were guilty before God. You know, in fact, people don't tend to become less sinful through the years and the generations. They tend to become more sinful through the years and generations. And that's what had happened with the Amalekites. Man, what they did initially as Israel left Egypt, that was wrong and sinful and wicked. And as you study the Amalekites' continuance of their people, those 400 years, they just become more and more sinful, more and more wicked. Why is that? Because people don't tend to become less sinful. They tend to become more sinful unless they've been transformed by the grace of Almighty God. Sin is progressive in its nature. It's progressive. It gets worse in its nature. You know, America's 244 years old. We just celebrated a birthday back on Saturday. Well, you think Americans are more or less sinful than we were at the beginning? 244 years, you think we're less sinful or more sinful? I bet we're more sinful. Why? Because sin's progressive. That's the nature of sin. It doesn't become less. It doesn't diminish. No, it increases. It becomes more. Well, imagine how much more sinful the Amalekites in Saul's day were than the ones who had attacked Israel after they left Egypt 400 years earlier. We, as Americans, have had 244 years for our sins to progressively grow worse. The Amalekites had had 400 years for their sins to progressively grow worse. So we tend to become more sinful, not less sinful, unless we're transformed by the grace of Almighty God. And we need to know tonight, friend, know that the sin in your life will progressively get worse unless you deal with it in Jesus. Unless you deal with it in Jesus. So, dear friend, if you've never trusted Christ, the best thing that could happen would be for you to trust Him tonight. And Christians, if you know Him, if there's some sin in your life, just know that if you don't address it, it's going to progress. And it will continue to get worse. And the only way for us to stop it is to deal with it and address it in Christ, bring it to Him, and ask for His forgiveness, and to ask for His transformation in our life. I hope these things we've talked about tonight have been helpful for you, and if these commands, that this command that God has given through Samuel to Saul are utterly demolish, utterly destroy the Amalekites, if that kind of idea, the idea of haram, divine warfare, if that's really troubled you, I hope that what we've been able to share tonight has been helpful for you and has maybe helped to reconcile some things and strengthen your faith and in no way disturb it, but to make it strong, but instead to make it stronger and more anchored in the Lord. And if there's something that you need to talk about, something that you've got more questions on, then we'd be glad to try and help you as best we can with that. But just know that what God's commanded here is in no way a violation of His character, no way a violation of His holiness, no way a violation of His goodness. And there's not any person in which the punishment of God has fallen who is completely and totally innocent. Right, so we pray that it'll be helpful for you, and as the weeks go on, we'll continue to walk through this chapter in 1 Samuel chapter 15. We want to move now and transition into a time of prayer, and I want to ask you to be remembering these folks in your prayer time. We emailed you a prayer list earlier, and I know we've had a little bit of trouble with some email addresses not receiving them, but in hopes that you have received it and that you can remember each of these folks in your prayer time. I want to ask you to pray for Cricket Jenkins. Ms. Cricket's got some shingles, and that, as many of you know, is incredibly painful. And so we want to ask you to lift up Ms. Cricket, if you will. She has prayed for countless folk through the years, and so let's be faithful to pray for her. Glenda Trammell had a heart cath on Monday at Muskogee St. Francis. They got one stent in there that was needful, and she was released to go back home and still dealing with some neck and back pain, and she's awaiting surgery for that. So if you would, pray for Miss Glenda in recovery from the heart cath, and then as prepares for surgery coming up, and we pray that that happens very soon and that it is very successful. Then I want to ask you to pray for Janie Cox as she recovers from back surgery, continuing to lift her up. David Boyers, he recovers from surgery on his foot, lifting up Carolyn Mays, Helen Rogers, Naomi Lusk, all of these ladies with cancer, asking you to lift them up. Evelyn Webb's got a great deal of pain in her hip and leg and has some appointments and various things trying to get that resolved. So if you would pray for Miss Evelyn. And then we've been asked to pray for Ronald Hornback, who also is dealing with shingles. And so there seems to be a little bit of an epidemic with shingles in our church family and in our community. And so if you would lift up Ronald, if you would please. And then continue to pray for the Vance family, Donna Vance, Brother Jack's wife, and then their children. If you would continue to pray for them, I know that they would be very grateful for that. But please remember them. And then continue to pray for our shut-ins, our nursing home residents. Carlene Salmons moved to Broken Arrow to be near to her granddaughters, but she still deals with quite a bit of pain on a continual basis. And so if you would lift her up, and remembering Thelma Roberts over at the Springs. We want to remember those over at Country Gardens. We've got BJ and Imogene over there. We want to lift them up and pray for their well-being. But many shut-ins, nursing home residents, we'll be praying for them. Lily Saylor, be praying for her, if you will. Also continuing to pray for Lee and Kelly Smith and caring for Linnell Boyer, and thankful to God for how that has gone thus far. Pray that that will continue to be a blessing there. And then please continue to pray for our nation and our nation's leaders and all the things going on in our world. It's definitely a tumultuous time. And we want to be praying for God to bring revival and spiritual awakening. We want to be praying for the evil and the wickedness to be put down. We'll be praying for righteousness to prevail in our land, and praying that there is a wholesale turning of people's hearts and lives back to the Lord Jesus Christ. Then continue to pray for our one. And we've got this container full of ping pong ball symbolic of people who need to be saved. And you continue to pray for your one, asking the Lord Jesus Christ to save them and to give them eternal life. Continue to pray for our church plants, and then continue to pray for our missionaries serving in the U.S. and abroad. And I would also encourage you to be praying for our evangelists, people that have been called by God to serve in that capacity. First, Ephesians 4, 11 and 12 tells us they're a gift to the church. But it's certainly been a hard time for them. And so if you would, please be praying for our evangelists. I'm sure there are other things that are on your heart that you're going to be praying for. We encourage you to do that. And if there's things that we can be praying about with you, if you will send us an email, send us a message, give us a call. If you're here in the building in person, you can write a note on one of the cards, put it in one of the offering boxes, and we promise to be praying with you about that. All right, so let's pray together tonight. Father, we love you, we praise you, and we bless you. You are a good Father. You're an awesome God. You're a caring God. And we praise you, Lord, for who you are. We thank you for your love for us. We thank you for how you've demonstrated that love countless times over and over again throughout the years. And God, I thank you that you are a God who cares for your people. And Lord, I lift up these names to you tonight, all being people that need a touch from you in some way. God, some of them need your comfort. They need your peace. Lord, some of them need healing. Lord, some of them need you working in their circumstances, making things happen and causing things to materialize. And Lord, we lift up every one of them and their needs to you tonight. And we pray, God, for your healing in their bodies. We pray for your healing in their spirits. Lord, we pray for your working in their circumstances and situations. We ask, Lord, that you would do it for their good and for the glory of your name. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you will be with our shut-ins and our nursing home residents. And we ask, God, that you would please minister to each one of them. And God, assure them of your nearness and love for them and our love for them. We pray for our nation. And God, we are troubled by what we see and what we hear. And Lord, we pray that you'll bring a revival here and spiritual awakening. We pray that God, people will turn their hearts and their minds and their lives back to Jesus. And we pray, God, that there would be a revival and an awakening that would happen in this land that would be unlike any that's ever happened before. God, I pray that there would be countless thousands of people repenting of sin and coming faith Christ. Lord, we pray you would let it be. Give our leaders wisdom, Lord, on every level of government. We ask, God, that you'll give all of our leaders in different organizations and entities, you'll give them wisdom as they have to make decisions. And Lord, we pray you'll guide them into what's best for them and for the people to whom they serve. Father, we continue to pray for those in our families, in our neighborhoods, our acquaintances, Lord, who are lost and who need to be saved. Bring them to an understanding of their lostness. And God, bring them to the place where they believe in Jesus and they trust him as Savior and as Lord. And God, I pray that in coming days we'll be seeing many of these folks walking down aisles, giving their life to Jesus, making public their faith in Christ. God, I pray for our missionaries that are serving here in the United States as well as abroad, the evangelists that are serving here and abroad. Lord, our church planters, would you please continue to provide for them. We continue to bless them. We continue to use them, Lord, for your sake, for the sake of the souls of humanity, and for the sake of your kingdom. And God, for it, we'll praise you. Lord, I lift up tonight Janie. I lift up Glenda. Lift up David to you. I lift up Evelyn to you. I lift up Carolyn. Lift up Naomi. I lift up Helen. I lift up Ronald. Lift up Cricket. I pray for every one of them, Lord, and I pray your healing on their bodies. And ask, Lord Jesus, that you would do a work of healing in their life for which you and you alone would receive the glory and the honor. We love you, Lord. We pray towards Sunday as we resume Sunday school. We pray your work in that. We pray your Holy Spirit would bless it. We pray, God, that there would be God things that will happen in the lives of people. We pray for our worship service that you'll be glorified and honored in it. We pray, Lord, that lives will be changed. Lord, we pray that this week, Lord, between now and Sunday, you'll give us souls for your kingdom. And God, I pray that we would be celebrating on Sunday with people whose lives have been saved, people who've been born again by the grace of Almighty God. Lord, we love you tonight. We pray in the name that's above every name, the name of Jesus. Amen. Hey, again, want to remind you that this Sunday we're resuming Sunday school in nearly all of our groups. So this Sunday morning, 9:30 a.m., if you're able, we would encourage you to be here on Sunday if you're able. And if you're just at that place where you're ready to recongregate, that you'll be here Sunday morning at 9:30 in your Sunday school class, participating there as you open God's Word together, pray together, fellowship together, and to serve the Lord together. If you are in Brother Adrian's class, so you're in the Hallelujah class, your class will not be meeting this Sunday morning at 9:30. Instead, your class will be gathering on Wednesday nights at 6:30, starting on July the 15th, a week from tonight. They'll be meeting in the fellowship hall July 15th, 6:30 p.m. And you're asked to wear a mask and to come and participate in that if you're a part of Brother Adrian's class. The rest of us will be regathering this Sunday morning at 9:30, and so I hope you'll be able to join us. For those of you that are continue to engage by video, we're glad you're doing that. We pray you'll continue to do that until that time is that you're ready to rejoin us in person. But encourage you to continue to engage with us by video. And whether you are in the house or whether you are watching by video, encourage you to share our feed with people on your feed, to invite people to participate with us, and that we can have more people hearing the gospel and having an opportunity to come to faith in Jesus. All right. I also want to remind you that Vacation Bible School, we're still planning on that. We'll be starting that on Monday, July the 20th at 9 a.m., run from 9 to noon. And so all kids who are sixth grade down to 3 years old, you can participate. You need to get registered. And if you can do, you can do that on our website, SEBCMuskogee.com. So I encourage you to get your children, your grandchildren registered for Vacation Bible School. That will be Monday through Friday, July the 20th through the 24th. And we hope you'll be participating in that, praying with us toward that, And we ask that this year we would see, we pray that the Lord would allow us to see this year more boys and girls coming to faith in Christ and growing in their commitment to Him and their love for Him, all right? Hey, have a great rest of your week. Know that I love you. Thank God for you. And excited about what God has in store for us in these days and in the days to come. Thankful that the mission of the church is going forward. And we want to be engaged in that, being faithful to carry out the mission that God has given to us and sharing about God's Son, engaging with God's Word, caring belonging to God's family, and caring with God's love. Say a good word about Jesus' church family. Say a good word about your church. See you soon.